After the discussion on different classes of schedules, we will now look at synchronization. That means you want to come up with protocols that a scheduler is using in order to allow only schedules of a certain class. And we will focus here on schedules for conflict serializable class. This illustration we have seen already. We see the transaction manager on top receiving actions from different transactions and then forwarding this to the scheduler. And now this is what we are looking in this section of the class. The scheduler is receiving these actions from the transaction manager and has to decide if the action can be forwarded to the data manager. And this is only forwarded when these actions are complying with a certain class of schedules this scheduler was designed for. And again, we will look at conflict serializable schedules. We will come up with some rules the scheduler has to adhere to. We can also call scheduling protocols and see why these rules are indeed producing only conflict serializable schedules. We will call, or we call such a protocol CSR safe if this protocol ensures that only schedules that fall into CSR are produced. An interesting discussion in this sense is the scheduling power. If this scheduler is able to generate the entire class, CSR only a subset. Of course, we want to have the scheduler to allow a maximum parallelism, so a degree of freedom in allowing concurrent transactions. And of course, it would be probably simple to say, or it is simple to say, we are creating a CSR-safe scheduler. The scheduler that is allowing only serial schedule is also CSR-safe, right? But of course, it doesn't really make sense in practice to use it, because it would be too restrictive. So we want to have a maximum degree of parallelism, and still the schedule should be guaranteed to fall into the class CSR. Here you see some simple pseudocode of a generic scheduler. So initial we have a state, and then we repeat forever until the database system is crashing, of course, the arrival of a new step. This is what these commands coming from the transaction manager. Then there's some internal state updated, and then important part here is that we're testing if this new step is compliant with the class we want to generate, or the schedule class, CSR in our case. And if it's fine, we output it to the data manager, otherwise we block it, or we are rejecting this step that came in. So this is like the general idea of a scheduler. So there are three actions following this pseudocode performed by the scheduler. First of all, the output operation. So we have input actions, read, write, commit in the board. And if it's fine, and these are okay regarding the class of schedules we want to allow, then the scheduler is outputting these actions, and then they are appended to the output schedule. And of course, this is the output schedule that is forwarded to the data manager. So this schedule has to be falling into our class CSR. In case there is a read or write action in the input and the scheduler cannot append this to the schedule, then it can be rejected and the transaction is aborting and can be restarted by the application or by the user later again. The scheduler can also decide to block an action, so if there is a read-write action coming and currently it cannot be appended to the output schedule, it can be blocked and appended later if it's possible. One class of schedulers are so-called lock-based schedulers, and the idea here is very simple. You're giving locks to objects so that the access to the object is synchronized using these locks. We will have two locks later on, read locks and write locks. And it's already clear by the discussion on conflict operations that two reads are okay, or multiple reads on the same object are okay, but transactions should not concurrently write or read write or write read objects, right? So every time there's at least one write involved, there is a problem, so we have read and write locks to ensure this. So the generic approach is that the scheduler requests for a certain action, of a transaction a log. The action also tells already what kind of log we want, a read log or a write log. And then the scheduler checks if there is already a log existing on this object and if this log is compatible with the log that is requested. So if there's a read log and there's a read log requested, everything is fine. If there was a read log and we want to have a write log, it's not fine, and so on. And exactly this is expressed here. In this illustration, we have here a current mode on object X, so the current log mode. NL means no log, R means read log, and X means exclusive log. This is equivalent to saying it's a write log. Here we have the requested log. So in case there was no log and there's a read log requested, we write RL to indicate the request of a read log. Then it's fine. So plus means it's granted. If there was an exclusive log here and we're requesting a read log, it's not granted, right? This is what the table tells. And here on the right hand side, we have the new mode of the object. So the new kind of log on the object, and it's clear if you have no log before, want to have read log, we have seen it can be granted. So then in the end, we have a read log on this object. This is how you're reading these two tables. But again, it's not surprising because that's already what we have learned in the discussion on conflict serializability, that we have these conflict operations. And we have a conflict when there's an access on the same object and there's at least one write operation. In order for these synchronization protocols for the scheduler to work using logs, there should be some rules to be followed. And here we see the so-called four rules of well-formedness. The first rule says for each operation, let's say it's a read operation, there must be a log request for this read before the actual read operation, of course. And there should be also an unlock operation after the actual read. Same, of course, for writes. If you have a write, there should be a write log request before the write happens and also an unlock. Second rule says there's at most one log request for read and write for one object and one transaction. So there are no redundant log requests. Third rule says there is no redundant unlock. And the fourth rule says if X is locked by a transaction TI and TJ, then that means that the logs have to be compatible, as the matrices or the tables from the previous slide indicated. The order in which logs are released does not really matter. And we assume that in case you have a read log and a write log on the same object, it is sufficient to do the unlock of the write. The read log is implicitly then removed. So here's the illustration of the famous two-phase locking protocol, 2PL. It's a protocol that works as follows. We have a schedule coming in, and the schedule has read and write operations. And now this protocol says how these locks can be or should be requested. And basically, it just says that there is no lock request following the first unlock. That means if you're illustrating it, you have some phase where you're requesting logs. So here's a number of logs growing. And when you first did an unlock here, you are not allowed to lock any more objects. You are only allowed to unlock. So you have like a growing phase and a shrinking phase. Hence the name two phase. First a phase of requesting logs and then a phase of unlocking. So again, there cannot be any lock request for one transaction after the first unlock. That's the simple protocol it is. There are variants of 2PL, for instance, the conservative 2PL. Here, the idea is that you do but it's called pre-claiming. When a transaction starts, you're requesting all the logs, then the transaction is operating, and then in the end you're unlocking. This would be kind of interesting because it would avoid deadlocks, because the transaction would get all the logs needed and then starts operating and would not be in trouble if it's requesting. Another one is also requesting. At some point, there will be a point reached when the transaction cannot anymore grow. This cannot happen in this pre-claiming conservative 2PL. Unfortunately, it's in practice not applicable, because how would you know all the logs you need at the beginning of the transaction? So if you think about a Java program talking to the database, and there are if statements and user inputs and so on, how would you know all the logs you need? It's not really possible to know, right? Then there are two variants which are interesting. They're called strict and strong 2PL. In the strict 2PL, all the exclusive logs, so the write logs, are kept until the end. So you have here the crawling phase, and then the transaction is operating, it's working, and in the end, all the logs are in one, or all the write logs are unlocked in one instant of time. The strong 2PL, SS2PL in short, is similar, just that all the logs are held until the end of the transaction, so the read logs and the write logs. Let's have a look at some example input schedule. We have here three transactions, and here we see the first action is a write by transaction 1 on X and the read of transaction 2 on X. And we know, of course, that read and write are not compatible in terms of logging. So let's see what the scheduler, the 2PL scheduler, is doing. First of all, there should be a log request for the write action. So we have here WL indicating for transaction 1 that transaction 1 wants to write to X. This is also granted because now here the write operation takes place. And in parallel, we have here transaction 2 wants to read, as we have seen here. So we have a read request here. But as you see indicated by these dots and this space here, this is not granted yet, because the read does not happen. The read happens only in this point in time. Why is this? Well, we have still the log, the write log, the exclusive log on X. So this cannot be granted, right? So we have to wait until the unlock comes, the unlock of the write log on X for by transaction 1. And then this one can be granted. And finally, we can read X from transaction 2. Here we have transaction 3 requesting a read log on Y. This is also granted immediately. And here you have, in parallel, a bit later, a write request on Y by transaction 1. And now transaction 1 has to wait up to the point when here the unlock comes by transaction 3, and then transaction 1 can also proceed with the operations. This is what 2PL causes, or locking causes, for this input schedule.